Father, I pray you'll help us as we preach this morning and Lord, the whole country today. But they say there's more people now committing suicide than in the history of our nation. More people on pills and drugs and all other kinds of just through life than has ever been in American history. And yet, Lord, this is just a phone book. And so I pray, God, you'll help us to help people. Be seated. David had reason to be distressed. The Bible said it's great to distress. They go home. From this, the city's burning. Now you imagine coming home. You know, it's just to see your family. They're not there. They've been kidnapped. They've all been taken. Everything's been ransacked, gone through. They've taken everything. And then the fact they set the city on fire. Vic Lake's burning. And all these men have been fell down on the ground and wept. So they had no more power to wait. They were brokenhearted. Then their brokenheartedness turned into bitterness. And they wanted to kill David as they were sorry. And you know that David didn't have one man but reason to stand with, not one man walking to find one David and lay down on his head. I'm just saying, go here, and I'm going to pray for you. I know you've got some people. Decisions to make on what to do. I just want you to know I'm standing with you. They wasn't here. I'm going to tell you something. In your life, it's the best thing to do. It's going to stand with you. And it's going to be a problem. I have a man this morning that's going into God's service. He's going to be there for you. And even if I was there, he can't go into hospital. So I got a lady and I'm going to church next week. It's going to be a vow that I'm going to be placed in the heart. And I let her in Christ. So we hear her out of the dead in Christ, my son, her mother in Christ. Some sweet people have ever met. And she's going in, you know, my wife can be there to play with him in his family, in his family, and be there. But let me tell you, she won't be by herself. The Lord will be there. But you know what I'm trying to say? Sometimes you like to see somebody to bless them. It's a blessing to see somebody. Last week I was in Michigan preaching, and I was in Lexington, and on the mountain half away, John Jenkins' daughter at high school, she got a little baby boy, 18 months old, named Hudson. Well, his little belly got to the swelling, and they took him to the doctor. Or not, we can get in the hospital. I don't think there's most of us. We got in there and did some nursing at the desk of sexism. How can you get in here? I said, to the door. And we told her we want to see it. She said, you can go over there. I'll call them. And we can take them to the hospital. We can come back and see it. She said, we pray for them. Well, oh, it's just so good to see somebody. It's just so good to see somebody. Well, you know, I thought about it when I was younger. Wait till I was down. I wish for my son. But wait a minute. David didn't tell anybody. But you know what he did? Old David got in there somewhere and fell down before God.
we can no doubt cry out to the Lord. And by the way, he's hurting as bad as the man was. But you know, if you're ever going to be a leader, you've got to go on whenever. And by the way, everybody, friends leading somebody. You know, you teenagers are leading a little junior. And mom and dad's leading all the children. Sunday school teachers are leading, bus captains are leading, pastors are leading, senior assistant pastors are leading. All of us are leading somebody. And you know, you got to go on. You have to go on. And you know, I've changed it, and I think about it a lot. I think about a lot of trying to lead this country. They wouldn't just come get up every day, but jump from your nose on front of every newspaper. And it's never, you know, people say to me, you're Ronald Reagan's first president. Let me tell you something. Everybody loves Ronald Reagan. Seems like everybody loved him. Now, he was a great president. I'm going to tell you anything about him. But everybody liked him. People loved him. And I tell you, if you took a leg and you're leading, and it looks like he's hard, nobody for him. And every magazine, and every paper, and everything is saying, you ain't done nothing wrong since you've been in there, but you have been. You know what? It's important for you. Well, it's David in the same faith. He was in the same way. He loved those men. He loved those people that got kidnapped. He cared. And he's hurting like they're hurting. But nobody thought about it. Let me tell you, God made that union. You can't. And people don't understand that. A preacher called me this morning. One of my preacher boys, he called me, he said, "Preacher, I don't understand." I said, "Son, welcome to the ministry." He said, "I don't understand." He said, "I'm trying to help these people. I got people turning on him and all that type of stuff." I said, "Brother, that's part of it. It's part of it." And he said, "What do you ask?" I said, "Love will go on. Love will go on." Well, what do you do there whenever you're just, you're under the gun? Discouraged. Well, let me give you some thunder. Let me say, when you're discouraged, watch God, not people. Keep your eyes on God. You better keep your eyes. You know, that's why Hebrews 12, 1 and 2 say, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Keep your eyes on the one that faith has never made a blunder. He's never wavered. He's never not know what to do. He's not ever. So keep your eyes on him. He'll know. So keep your eyes on the Lord. And that's exactly what David did. David went straight to God. And in verse number 6, it is here. And David was greatly distressed for the people that spake and stoned him because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and his daughters. But David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. And you know what he did? He went straight in verse 7 to the prayer place. That's the first thing he did. He went straight to the prayer place. Now, let me tell you something, folks. When you get discouraged, the best place in the world to go, first, it is the best place to go, is let God's word help you. He had that word from God. Nobody didn't know what to do, but I'll tell you, this book will always have the answers. And you get this book, and you get along with God, and you find you somewhere when you get down, and you get a place, and you get this book, and you open it, and you let God talk to you real good, and then you roll over on your knees, and you start talking to God. And let me tell you, you'll come out of that different person because you've got your eyes on God. You know, Simon Peter, and he gets a lot of criticism from people. He really was the leader of that disciple group. And he was the only one, I tell you, Matthew 14, when he said, "Lord, if it's you, bid me come unto you." And Peter got out of that boat and began to walk with Christ. But the Bible said, but when he saw the waves and the wind boiled, he began to sink. You know what? For a little bit, just for a little bit, he got his eyes off the God. But let me tell you something. You get your eyes on the world today, it is no wonder people are discouraged and depressed. Let me say this to you. And whatever Brother Bill tells you to do is exactly what you do. Brother Bill, I believe this. I know this is true even about myself and my people. Watch too much news. And I ask you, used to do. I don't know what that's going to be, but I'm talking about Fox and all of those things. If you're not careful, because it's not going to be one thing on it, take it encouragement. Every time you turn it on, it's the numbers are going up. Dr. Fluffy Head said this, and Dr. So-and-so said this, and Dr. Lightbottom said this, and they said this. Well, folks, so, you have to think about what did the great physicians say? What did they say? What did God say? Is there, Jeremiah said, is there any word from the Lord? And he said, there is. Well, let me tell you, Brother Manny, there's still it. You hear from heaven in the morning, you can have it all day long. And the best thing to do is listen. And I'm not saying don't ever look at the newspaper, because you need to be a little bit informed what's going on, maybe. But you don't need to just sit and glue yourself to the newspaper and the radio, too much of that talk stuff and too much of that watch that stuff. If you're not careful, it'll get you in it. And let me tell you something, there's people right now. And they've lost so much of that stuff, they may not never be tired. I had a man last week request prayer. He had a man's prayer meeting Saturday night. We prayed that he works with. They said that the man he works with, his wife, and they're Christians, they're people go to church. If he got so discouraged and depressed from watching news and stuff, he's in a hospital. Got him so down that he's scared and afraid to the point that it put her in the hospital. You know, the Bible said the fear of man brings a snare. Proverbs said. Now, what we need is fear of God. We're fearing the wrong thing. What we need is fear of God. And the problem is, we don't have any fear of God, and we're afraid of all this stuff out here. And we've got our eyes off of God, see? And we need to get to looking at God. You know what God told Moses when they got down on the Red Sea and they left out of Egypt, looked like they were great victory. Got down there, now there's the Red Sea in front of them, and Pharaoh his army down. And the people said, yeah, you brought us down here because there wasn't no graveyard space down there. You just let them slaughter us down here and bury us down into the Red Sea. Moses cried out to God, and God said, Moses, stand still and see. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. You know what that means? That means stand still and watch me. You just keep your eyes on me, you'll be all right. And then when he started getting his eyes on God, God said, what you got in your hand? Take that rod, hold it out over the Red Sea. And brother, that water rolled back like a scroll. And they went through their dust was boiled up on their feet when they walked through that bottom of that sea floor. And let me tell you something, friend. What we need to do is get our eyes on the Lord. Watch God. See, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Whenever they got that orchestra, that pagan king got to play them. And everybody filled their rakes and shovels down and all their tools. And everybody just bowed down and started bowing down. Oh, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They said, you better get down to that golden image. You better get up to the king's music's playing. And they said, we're not going to. You know why their eyes was on another god? And they said, we're not no king called a man. And they said, our God is able to deliver us, and he will, but if not, he's able, and he will. But if he don't, we're going to burn them down. We've got our eyes on the Lord. And I'll tell you something else, Brother Richardson. Not only did they have their eyes on God, God had their eyes on them. And when that fire got lit, they got a good night. And it was killing the men that led them up there to throw them in or something. But they throw them in there, and they're walking around. And the king, standing way as far as he could stand, looked back, and he said, how many did we put in there? He said, three. He said, Lord, I said, four. God let that old king get looking for it. And let me tell you something. The only way to make it is to discern where we got to have it. old Isaiah, as I got mad, he laid his eyes on the wrong thing. And let me say this right here. Let me tell you something. Everybody thinks everything's going to be all right in November if I preach it. Just listen. I got news for you. Look right here. I love our preaching and I pray for it. I don't try to kill it for you. I got news for you. You better be looking at it. That's the problem, right? God's wanting you to look above that. See, the heart of the king is going to go out. God's the one that's going to take you somewhere, won't you? And you know what? In the year 10 years Uzziah died, I also saw the Lord. You know what? Too many Christians today get their eyes on the wrong thing. And you can't do a thing for God with your eyes on the wrong thing. Your eyes is very important to what you're looking at affects my eyes, affects my heart. You know what? I was in Amarillo, Texas Airport years ago, preaching, been in Amarillo holding the baby. They bought me, I like a preacher because I like cowboy boots and hats. And I love it. I like them with cowboy boots. And then I was looking for these. I turned that way to be back up. They bought me a pair of Tommy Long cowboy boots and a big old one in Tom Mix. Now, those of you who don't know about the old cowboys, Tom Mix. Tom Mix had a pumpkin gallon and made it to bed. So here I am. To the airport, I said, I don't have a way to put this thing in a suitcase. I just put it on my head and put it. You know, and they don't have a big old Tommy Long cowboy boots, and they had that cowboy hat on in the Amarillo. And I went to the airport and said, I was over there reading my Bible. I looked across to the streets where I seen a man standing there, fellow, dressed nice and everything. And I don't know, there's something about that. That's a good book to read now. I said, sure it is. He said, what kind of Bible is that? I said, it's a King James. And he said, it's a Schofield reference, man. Oh, he said, I remember that Schofield. He said, I wonder what I'm going to do. He said, Jim, I need to explain it. He said, could you read some Darrell Cox? He said, I'm sorry, man. I said, well, you don't know that. I said, I'm teaching with a lady. Me too. He said, preacher, you reached down and you know, that was so hard this day to do this book. And when I looked at the book, it was a picture of him and Elvis Presley on the front of his book. He said, and he had your arm on him, and he said, that's my brother. He said, my mother. He's not traveling with him, he's not having a fantastic beginning. he said, I went to high school with him. And his little old girl had been trying to do this thing. She went to him before. Trying to do this thing. And he said, I'm just going to go home. But he said, I don't know if things are going to happen. But he said, but the night Christ had the hurricane on top of it, came the word of God. And he said, here's the first one to his family. He said, preacher, if you help me to the Lord, I got saved and went off to Bible college in Florida. Finished Bible college and went to Bible college. Finished Bible. And I said, yeah, I said, you had an Isaiah. He said, what? I said, in here, and I was just teaching the Lord. King of rock and roll, just king of two. And you know what's planned, though? Many. Is your son. What will your eyes see? And boy, once you get your eyes on God, and you really got your eyes on God, let me tell you something, I'll be honest with you. You really got your eyes on the Lord, your faith in God. And I'm not playing down this thing about just virus, not a faith for you. But let me tell you something. You'll get through it without getting depressed. Now, I get out of your faith. Really, I get sideways because of the stupidity of things. Folks, I'll be honest, I'd rather get to stuff and get on and get it over with than would live in fear. You see, and all that means to you, if God wants you out here, he don't need nobody. He'll yank you out here anytime he gets ready. Brother, let me tell you, every time you go down the road, you're that far from God. I'm just simply saying, quit letting us touch fresh air. What do you do, preacher? You try to come along. Let me pray that to you. Then when you discourage it, not only watch God, but wait on God and pray. Wait on God and pray. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. And they wait for the time. Wait. David waited out. You know what he did? Lord, my wife is gone. My children's gone. The city's burned. The Amalekites have took them. Lord, what shall I do? And you know what he said? Well, one word. Pursue. Pursue. For thou shalt surely recover all. And David got it. That's it, boys. Mount up. Get your stuff. Put sleep bag across the back of your horse. Let's roll. I just heard from heaven. It's all right, boys. We're going to get it all back. Let's go. You know what it is? He got an answer from God. You know something? We can get answers too if we don't pray. But what if we're so busy? If you spend half the time in prayer, we do another. He said, if anybody's ever asked me to pray for him, I still pray. And he had let it go where he could see thousands of preachers and church members and pastors and evangelists and the clergy. You didn't have to have the truth to pray, you could do it. But you could do it. What I'm trying to say is, he wasn't worried. He was 92. He didn't miss the service. He sat right where you're sitting, saying, "This is it." And they don't even know that they believe. They put him in the grave. They put him in the grave. They don't even know that he looked like he was in the basket. So he died from the grave. Listen, we've got to get to prayer. If we're going to, you know what's going to save America? If Christians before God really get back. Wait on God in prayer. Then let me tell you right here, the will of God, the will of God. just pray. He had to go do something after him. Go do something after him. Find out what God wants. Pursue. They went and bowed down and took off. You know what we got to do? You can't just pray for people to be saved. You got to go out where they are. And you can't just pray for God to take care of something. You got to keep. You can't. You do what you can do. You don't marry and Martha when Lazarus died. Brother Johnson, they did have to move the rock away from the door. The Lord expected them to do what they could, and I'm sure they had some men helping them, but Jesus walked out there and said, move the stone away from the door. Now, Jesus could have spoke to that rock, and he took off rolling and turned to powder, whatever he wanted to do. But he wanted them to do what they could. Remember what he said about Mary and Bethany? She had done what she could. See, some people, they want God to do everything. But what we need to do is do what we can. And without him, realize you can do nothing without him, John 15, 5. But brother, with him, we can do anything. And one thing we ought to do is what's written down in black and white, obey the commandment. If you love me, keep my commandments. So the will of God obeys them. Now, then they went after him, verses 7 and 8. See? And here in verse 7 and 8, he went after him. So David went in verse 9. He and 600 men, verse 9, that were with him. Now, we show something else. When you're distressed and disturbed, don't get busy. Look at verse 10. But David pursued he and 400 men, or 200 abode behind, which was the fact they could not go over the book of Israel. And they found an Egyptian in the field, brought him to David, and gave him bread, and he did eat, and they made him drink water. And they gave him a piece of cake of figs and two clusters of raisins, and when he had eaten, his spirit came again, for he had eaten no bread nor drunk any water 3 days and 3 nights. Now, let me show you something here. You know what David done? David is still saying, you talk of what kill you right here. You can't get bitter with people and all this stuff going on. People need God. And you can't get bitter over something that's come your way. You know what? I don't like it. In my church, we went from hundreds, running hundreds of buses and feed stuff. It kind of ain't what I'm saying for our place. And when we went down, the word, I'm not going to get bitter at people or God. They don't care. I can't do nobody no good bitter. You can't do nobody no good bitter. Have you ever seen a bitter man help anybody? I haven't. And David didn't get bitter at that command that had part in what happened back then. He might have been one had to box the blessings with the fire. But David, what did he do? He fed water. And the man's spirit came again, and he said, just promise me you won't turn me back over to them for you to kill me. He said, I'm not. And he said, I'll tell you where they went, and where they're going, and all that. So God used an Egyptian to tell David where to go. Now, let me say something else. He didn't get bitter at people telling him to keep going. Let me tell you, we got people stopping the church right now. And it's all still there, pastor. You know, I'm afraid of life. I'm not going to climb up these guys, get these 3 stairs, about 30, 40 feet up there, kill a dude. If I can't stand on the ground and kill him, he's going to eat one the wrong way. And it's not even a car or something. I'm not crawling up to no tree. But my arm gets narrow, or falling out and getting broke out over a day. One time I crawled up in something like that, if it hadn't been for Jesus, I wouldn't have done it. I was a deacon of a Baptist church, and they put a roof on it. I mean, it was steep to the top, and I prayed and fasted, that's God, it got broke out. Just put this roof, because it's my job getting put shingles on it. And when we went up there, a little after daylight, and Brother Richard, I said, the boys, look, I'm going to tell you what's wrong. I'm going up here, but I'm coming down with John Stuff. When they went down for lunch, I said, I'll be here when y'all get back. You were afraid that somebody would be all right. I'll be sitting right up here. I'm coming off here and coming back out. I said, "Well, he left." He was still here. He comes back. I said, "I'm not coming down that ladder again." What? I would follow. I'm going to be up here nailing and hammering. And when the job's done, I'm coming back. But not in jail. That's the only roof I've ever done. That's the only one I'll ever do. I'm the pastor now. I'm going to hire a dog. I'll raise the money. I'll raise the money. Just give me a week and I'll let you folks. We need a roof on here. We'll give this, we'll give that. Amen. I'm afraid of that. So I understand, but I'm not afraid of that. I'm afraid of a biting pit bull dog. Now, I'm afraid of a pit bull dog. I'm afraid of a thousand of those. I'm afraid of half a pit. I'm not afraid of other things I'm not afraid of. But I'll tell you this. You may have a fear that I don't fear, but I will get better if you call me. I don't understand your fear. So if you're careful, we can find our church with people. And we can get to where we become Pharisees and say, "Yeah, well, if you have faith in God, you come." I don't understand why you don't. But I will turn against somebody pastoring for 25 years because they're afraid to come. And I got my piano player's got cancer right now. And she has no immune system. She is the most faithful person in our church. She won't come that way. She gets it. It probably won't come. I've told her, "Don't come. Watch it online. Donna, don't come. You don't need to be here. You don't need to be here." I call her, check on her, send her cards. I pray for her. But you don't need to be there. Now, here's what I'm trying to say. Don't get bitter. You know, Mr. Governor, I'm not for what y'all doing over here. That's protest. These have a crowbar that ties the door off your place and set it on fire and tear the thing out that you had for another. That right there, that's totally against the law. That's lawlessness. But what I'm trying to say is people need God. If a man had done this, he would be very, very, very wicked, vain. It's anti-Christ, anti-American, anti-God. But I can't allow myself to get hatred where I let people get bitter. Then I'm going to put bitterness in the people I'm trying to help God. Are you following? All right, so don't get this. David, he could have killed that Egyptian, my friend, but he failed. And he actually turned it around, got something out. Now he's doing something else. He didn't get bitter to once he couldn't keep up. They just got 200 of them and couldn't keep up. And they said, it says they stayed by the step. But John's done about three here, and I'm going to let you have it. Look right here. Staying by the step. What was the step? I believe David, they thought they was in for a long haul. And they took stuff they thought they'd need. And then when they found out they're not too far ahead, they lightened in their animals and left some things they could do with that. And they said, "You mean to stay here by the stuff. You stay by this. You stay by the stuff, and we'll make better time because the animals that they're going could run faster." You see what I'm trying to say? And then there were some Pharisees with David that when they got their wives back, they got their stuff back, and they come back by the brook of Besor, when they come back by there, they said, "Don't give them back nothing. Just send them walking." And David said, "Oh, no. give them back their wives, give them of the spoil, give them their stuff back. And so shall his part be that carried back the stuff. He carried back the stuff. He was faithful. But it helped us too by carrying back that stuff so we could go accomplish our mission. So, let me just say this. When you get discouraged, just listen to me. Say what stuff. Say what stuff. You know what I'm going to do? If you ever do this, they make every law they want to make. I'm going to keep praying. They can't stop praying. And they can't stop the plan of this book. I don't care if they have a governor and the whole young faith makers. Nobody's allowed to read the Bible. I promise. I got some media on the face of the top schedule. Oh, I still want to. I got more Bibles than church publishers, really. I got Bibles everywhere. I mean, we got Bibles everywhere. And you know what I'm going to do? God give me the eyes, and I'm going to read it. I wish I knew it better. I'm like here, but lots of stuff I read just scratch my head. God, I don't understand. I don't understand how it went to end or pulls back. I thought about that book. And as she done that, the only thing I'm saying, God just allowed it to happen. There's a lot of things. I ain't got no answer for it. But I'll tell you what, I'm worried about what I do have answers for. I'm facing God for what I already know. So I'm going to keep trusting Him, watching Him, reading the books, studying the books, keep on handing out tasks, keep witnessing, keep showing it. I'm going to keep on tithing. I'm going to keep giving. And listen, as long as my legs will carry me, I'm going to walk through the doors of the church house. I'm coming. I'm going to do everything I've done all my life. Listen to this when I'm done. Lee Robertson was with me in a meeting. His wife told my wife, you know, I had one day after he told me the story of what happened with Darrell Cox. With him, and it may have been what God knows. Dr. Robertson's wife, Mrs. Robertson, told my wife. She said, well, he is going to miss she said, I'm not quite right. She said, after he resigned the Highland Park, she said, one morning he got up and it was about 5 inches of snow. He got up that morning, she said, I would tell us that he was listening to the regular podcast on, you know, down by the stretch of the day. And the pastor at that time, I guess, was getting into the understanding, there's no church today, it's canceled in the Highland Park to do the church. Had double breasted blue navy suit on and second shoes. Ms. Robertson said, honey, where are you going? He said, I'm going to the same place I've gone all my life. Sunday morning, going to the house of God. He said, well, they just announced on the Highland Park station there's no church today. Dr. Robertson said, I was pastor there for 40 years. In 6 months, he always protects 6 months on that. Not just 40 years, 40 years, 6 months. And I never canceled service. I'm going. She said, but there's nobody there. He said, I'll be there. And she said, eat breakfast. Told my wife to eat breakfast. Ladies, rattle. Got me quite cut right back to have a driveway and go over to Highland Park, took the key out like the front door. Nobody touched the steps, brother. Nobody even touched the steps. Nothing was cut off. And there's that man with his knife. Walks up to the steps, goes in that church. Turns those lights on, about 6,500 feet up to him. Walks down the aisle, takes his old Bible, gets up in the pulpit, and reads a chapter or two to the community. Makes some comments. Goes to the altar and prays, and then walks out and turns the lights off and gets his heart to his heart. I never did see Lee Robertson discouraged. I've seen him before this, but where I don't know what I've tried to do. I don't know how to put food down. But the lights kept on going. And let me tell you something. Maybe there's no room for that. You know what we all need? You're a signboard for Jesus. Jesus. This whole world is looking for answers, and they need to see us smile on our faces. And they need to see us consistent in the way we dress. They need to see us still going to the house of God. They're real. They got something like that. I wish they had. You know what? When you throw it, you still obey it. And then take it all with all the end of the road. Thank God for a man to pray. A man to please God's word. When you follow it. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you will help us today in discouraging days, but Lord, we're not discouraged. Help us to stay encouraged because we got a Bible that's as true as it was the day you gave it to us. Absolutely true from cover to cover of the Word. Lord, prayer still works. The gospel still the power of God and salvation to everyone that believes. And Lord, the old church is alive and well. And Lord, we still got each other. We still have you. We still, Lord, got a mission that needs accomplished. Help us to not get discouraged and down and defeated and bittered. Lord, we're not that way. We can't be used. Help us to stay up on top of that. I'm sure there's problems. Sure there's problems. Along with everything else that comes along. All that's going on in our nation. Lord, there's nothing new under this problem. We pray you'll help us. That's Brother Johnson, as he preaches. Thank you for Brother Bell. And this preacher, Brother Richards, and Brother Manny, these other preachers and pastors who speak to you. Bless their churches. Bless Anchor Baptist. Thank you for this place being an anchor to this community. And they look at it and say, it's solid. And the people that are members, we've got a solid place.